പ്രിയപ്പെട്ടവരെ, കെ എസ് ടി എ സംസ്ഥാന അക്കാദമിക് സബ് കമ്മിറ്റിയുടെ നേതൃത്വത്തിൽ നടത്തുന്ന പ്രഭാഷണ പരമ്പരയിലെ മൂന്നാമത്തെ പ്രഭാഷണമാണ് ഇന്ന് നടക്കുന്നത്. ജൂലൈ 11 ലോക ജനസംഖ്യാ ദിനമാണ്. ജനസംഖ്യാ ദിനത്തോടനുബന്ധിച്ച് ഇന്ന് നടത്തുന്ന ഈ പ്രഭാഷണം നടത്തുന്നത് പ്രൊഫസർ സി ഇരുദയരാജനാണ്. ഇന്റർനാഷണൽ ഇൻസ്റ്റിറ്റ്യൂട്ട് ഓഫ് മൈഗ്രേഷൻ ആൻഡ് ഡെവലപ്മെന്റിന്റെ ചെയർമാനായും നൊമാഡ് തീമാറ്റിക് വർക്കിംഗ് ഗ്രൂപ്പിന്റെ ചെയർമാനായും പ്രവർത്തിക്കുന്ന അദ്ദേഹം ദേശീയവും അന്തർദേശീയവുമായ വിവിധ ജേർണലുകളിൽ ഇത് സംബന്ധിച്ചുള്ള ലേഖനങ്ങൾ എഴുതുകയും പബ്ലിക്കേഷൻ നടത്തുകയും ചെയ്തതാണ്. അദ്ദേഹത്തെ തന്നെ ഇന്ന് കെ എസ് ടിയുടെ പ്രഭാഷണത്തിന് കിട്ടിയതിന് വളരെ സന്തോഷമുണ്ട്. സംസ്ഥാന കമ്മിറ്റിക്ക് വേണ്ടി നിങ്ങൾക്കെല്ലാവർക്കും വേണ്ടി അദ്ദേഹത്തെ സ്വാഗതം ചെയ്യുന്നു. ലോക ജനസംഖ്യ വളരെ വേഗത്തിൽ വർദ്ധിച്ചുകൊണ്ടിരിക്കുകയാണ്. ലക്ഷക്കണക്കിന് വർഷങ്ങൾ കൊണ്ടാണ് 100 കോടി ജനങ്ങൾ എത്തിയതെങ്കിൽ പിന്നീട് 200 വർഷം കൊണ്ട് അത് 700 കോടിയിലേക്കും ഇന്ന് 770 കോടിയിലേക്കും ജനസംഖ്യ എത്തിയിരിക്കുകയാണ്. ഇത് വലിയ പ്രത്യാഘാതമാണ് ഉണ്ടാക്കുന്നത്. ലോകത്തെ വിവിധ വിഭാഗം ജീവികൾക്കിടയിൽ മനുഷ്യരുടെ മാത്രം ജനസംഖ്യ ഇങ്ങനെ വർദ്ധിക്കുന്നത് നമ്മുടെ ആവാസ വ്യവസ്ഥയെയും പ്രകൃതിയെയും വലിയ രൂപത്തിൽ ദോഷകരമായി ബാധിക്കുകയാണ്. ഇത് മറ്റു ജീവികളെ മാത്രമല്ല, മനുഷ്യരുടെ ജീവിതത്തെ പോലും ഗുരുതരമായി ബാധിക്കുന്ന സ്ഥിതിവിശേഷമാണ്. അതുകൊണ്ടാണ് യു എൻ 1989 മുതൽ തന്നെ ലോക ജനസംഖ്യാ ദിനം ആചരിക്കാൻ ആരംഭിച്ചത്. ഓരോ ദിനം ആചരിക്കുമ്പോഴും ആ ദിനത്തിൽ ഉയർത്തിവിടുന്ന ആശയങ്ങൾ വിവിധ തലങ്ങളിൽ ചർച്ച ചെയ്യുന്നു. അത് നമ്മുടെ രാഷ്ട്രീയേതര മേഖലയിലെ അജണ്ടയായി മാറണമെന്നുള്ളതാണ് ഉദ്ദേശിക്കുന്നത്. അതുകൊണ്ടാണ് ഈ വിഷയം ചർച്ച ചെയ്യണമെന്നുള്ളത് കൊണ്ടാണ് കെ എസ് ടി എ ഈ വിഷയത്തിൽ പ്രത്യേക പ്രഭാഷണം നടത്താൻ, അത് ജനങ്ങളിലേക്ക് എത്തിക്കാൻ തീരുമാനിച്ചത്. ജനസംഖ്യ വളരുന്നത് മനുഷ്യരുടെ തന്നെ ദാരിദ്ര്യത്തിന് കാരണമായിത്തീരും. ദാരിദ്ര്യത്തിന് കാരണം ജനസംഖ്യ മാത്രമല്ല, നമ്മുടെ ഭൂമിയിലെ സ്വത്ത് ഒരു വിഭാഗം ചെറു ന്യൂനപക്ഷത്തിന്റെ കയ്യിൽ അകപ്പെട്ടിരിക്കുകയാണ്, അവർ അടക്കി ഭരിക്കുകയാണ് എന്നുള്ളത് കൊണ്ടുകൂടിയാണ് അങ്ങനെ സംഭവിക്കുന്നത് എന്ന് നമുക്കറിയാം. വ്യവസ്ഥിതി കൂടി മാറിയാലെങ്കിൽ മാത്രമേ നമ്മുടെ പട്ടിണി മാറ്റാൻ കഴിയൂ എന്ന് തിരിച്ചറിയുന്നവരാണ് കെ എസ് ടി. ഞാൻ ദീർഘിപ്പിക്കുന്നില്ല. ഈ ദിനത്തിൽ നമ്മുടെ ക്ഷണം സ്വീകരിച്ച് ഈ പ്രഭാഷണം തയ്യാറായ പ്രൊഫസർ എസ് ഇരുദയരാജനെ ഞാൻ നിങ്ങൾക്കെല്ലാവർക്കും വേണ്ടി ഹാർദവമായി അഭിവാദ്യം ചെയ്യുന്നു. അദ്ദേഹത്തെ പ്രഭാഷണം നടത്തുന്നതിന് വേണ്ടി സ്വാഗതം ചെയ്തുകൊള്ളുന്നു. നന്ദി, നമസ്കാരം.
ഡിയർ ഫ്രണ്ട്സ്, ഫസ്റ്റ് ഓഫ് ഓൾ ഐ വുഡ് ലൈക്ക് ടു താങ്ക് ദ കേരള സ്കൂൾ ടീച്ചേഴ്സ് അസോസിയേഷൻ ഫോർ ഇൻവൈറ്റിംഗ് മീ ടു ഗിവ് എ സ്പെഷ്യൽ ടോക്ക് ഓൺ ദ വേൾഡ് പോപ്പുലേഷൻ ഡേ July 11. And I am thankful to both Anislav and Safi for coordinating with me for this talk. Before I start, I would like to say few words about July 11. Why July 11 is celebrated as World Population Day? In fact, if you have to go back to the history of starting the World Population Day, I am very glad to inform you that our founder president H.C. Zakaria of the International Institute of Migration Development while he was in the World Bank, decided the date, July 11, to celebrate the World Population Day when the world crosses 5 billion in 1987. We are celebrating for last 34 years this event. And currently, H.C. Zakaria, who suggested this date in Washington, now lives in Kerala. And he is 98 years old. I just spoke to him today morning. We have to look that someone from Kerala fixed the day for the global World Population Day celebrations. As I said earlier, 5 billion is the mark of the World Population Day in July 11. But if you look at it globally, let us look back how the population in the world is growing. For example, as per the data what we have, 1 billion of people globally was recorded in 1802. And it reached 2 billion in 1927. That means it took 120 years to double from 1 to 2 billion. And then we reached 3 billion in 1960. So 1 to 2, we took 123 years. And 2 to 3, adding 1 billion, we took just 33 years. That indicates we were growing very fast. And it increased to 4 billion in 1974. Again, we took 14 years to add 1 billion. And then we increased to 5 billion in 1987, where we started celebrating as a world population to remember the world that we are growing, 5 billion people in the world. So it was in 1987. We increased to 6 billion in 1999. We took just 12 years to add 1 billion. And 2011, we increased to 7 billion. Again, 12 years. And we are expecting 8 billion in 2023. Again, 12 years. That means we are growing faster than earlier days. Now, when we talk about population, this is the world population we are talking about. The population growth is basically by three important components. I will come back to that little later. The components are birth, death, and migration. Through birth, we are adding people to the world. That's why we always call them plus. Deaths, it is minus, we are negative. Somebody dies, we are minusing them from the world. And then plus or minus migration. Migration can be positive, migration can be negative. For example, 100 people are leaving from Kerala to Dubai. Kerala lost 100 people for the time being, and Dubai has gained 100 people. This is something we should keep in mind. So the birth is always plus, death is always negative. Migration can be either positive or negative. Let me come back to the situation of India. Now, India, we had 361 million people when India in 1951. So, in 1951, after we got independence, 1951, India reported 361 million and it increased to 846 million in 1991. And we reached 1 billion of people in 2001. World had 1 billion in 1804. The whole world had 1 billion in 1804. India alone had 1 billion in 2001. And 2011, we crossed 1.2 billion. 1.2 billion. And we are expected to reach 1.6 billion around 2050. 2050, India will reach close to 1.6 billion. What about our neighbors? China. Currently, India is equivalent to 17% of the world population. That means, out of 100 people in the world, 17 are Indians. Out of 100 people, 17 are Indians. If you include China, a major population giant, we call them. Today, China is number one in terms of the world population size. So if you include them, another 16% of the world population will be between India and China. That means India and China together will occupy 36% of the world population. That means out of 3 people globally, when you meet, one person is likely to be either Indian or Chinese. Very, very important point to understand. We are holding 36% of the world population, these two countries. So we are powerful, these two countries, in terms of population size. Are we powerful in terms of economics? Are we powerful in terms of military power? Powerful in terms of our voice globally? I think these are the things we should discuss more. Not in this lecture, but in your own circle. Are we number one and number two? Only in demography. And today, when I talk to you, China is number one in the world in terms of population size. And India is number two. Of course, India is waiting for quite some time to take over China to become number one in the world in terms of population. We are all waiting when we will be number one. Everybody wants to become number one. If you run a race, you want to be number one, get gold medal. Number two will get silver medal. Number three will get bronze medal. Other people have no role. 100 people even running, that's only one person will get the gold medal. Now, till now, China is getting gold medal in terms of population size. Number one. And we want to get gold medal at least in population. Yes. When we are going to get? As per the latest data, India will overtake China in 2027. Another 6 to 7 years from now. Because 6 to 7 years are crucial. But within 6 to 7 years, and most of you can celebrate that India is number one. I think we all will be alive to see India overtaking China in terms of population size. And that time, population will be close to 1.3 billion. That's important. So we are ready to overtake China. Now, when we talk about population, there are two important components which affect population. One is births. Second is deaths. Why we took 130 years to increase the population from 1 billion to 2 billion? Because we have equal number of births and number of deaths. In 1800, for example, 100 people are born, 100 people died. So growth is zero. So there is no growth of population. There is no growth of population. That's why the population took 1800 years to get 1 billion. 1800 years they took 1 billion to reach 1 billion. Then they, I told you, 132 years for 1 to 2, then now we are taking only 12 years. Now, as a human being, what many policymakers did, they said it is too bad, people are dying like flies. We are seeing people are dying now during COVID-19. It's a lot of people died. Indian government says close to 400,000 people died due to COVID. But some people have died post-COVID complication. Maybe the number is not correct. Many people are saying this is more than doubled. This is not the correct number. Many people are dying due to COVID in India. They are not reporting properly. They are not reporting in China. Everybody talks about under-reporting of deaths. But please remember, every country in the world want to reduce deaths. So what happened, if you look at it historically, between 1900 and 1950, all the countries in the world were putting policies and programs to reduce death rates. They want to reduce death rates. Now we are talking about COVID vaccination. Do you remember? In those days we got a malaria vaccination, we have TPT, we have measles vaccination. So many vaccinations were introduced in globally. That's why we know about vaccination. Now we are talking about COVID-19 vaccination. But vaccination is part of the human life to control mortality, control morbidity. We are trying to control mortality. So every government have decided to invest lot of money to reduce mortality. So what happened at the end of the day? End of the day, it's very simple. We have reduced mortality. For example, 100 people born. Earlier 100 people used to die. Then the growth is zero. 100 born, 100 death equal to zero. But now 100 people born, the number of death is only 50. That means you are adding every minute 50 people. Because 100 people born, only 50 died. So you are 100 today born and 50 left out from last day. So we were adding the population because of the birth increasing one side and the death declining the other side. You have two-way process. One side, the births are increasing, the other side, deaths are coming down. Then what happened? We all thought the population is growing. What we decided between 1950 to 2000, we thought we are producing too much. People are not dying. For example, I remember my mother used to tell me, my grandmother had 9 children. You can all imagine, you go back to your house, you talk to your parents, you talk to your grandparents. If your great grandparent is still alive, maybe 80 plus or 90 plus, ask them how many children they had. Most of them had, number of children were very, very high. 8, 12, I talked to some people, somebody had even 14. But please remember, 14 is the children they have seen. There may be fetal wastages. There may be spontaneous abortions. Lot of things might be happening, but we are talking about live birth. That means my grandmother had produced 9 children, live births. And the 9th was my mother. And today, I don't think any couples in this country is producing 9 children. Any couples. I'm sure people who are listening, the teachers, I don't think you have any teacher currently having 9 children. In fact, very few of you will have even 3 children. 3 children is abnormal in Kerala today. Abnormal. 1 is normal. 2 is new normal. And 3 is abnormal. And many couples want to have just one child. In today, Kerala alone, 20% couples have just one child. Just one child. And 10% couples cannot have children. What we call them childless couples. So 30% is over. And another 20 to 30% will have just two children. Today in Kerala, you will have just close to 3 to 4% couples will have three children. The next generation, you will not find couples. No couples will have more than one even. Even one, they will find it difficult. Where the infertility will go up. So that is the reality. So what we did as a government, as a policymaker, 1900 to 1950, we were spending time to reduce mortality. For example, when India got independence, an average Indian used to live less than 50 years. But today, Indian lives 70 years. A Malayali child born today can live 70 years. 70 years, a child born today in Kerala can live 70 years. If everything goes on well, like economics we say, certain things remaining the same. And an average Keralite can live 70 years. An average Indian can live 62, 63 years. But what happened 50 years back? And an average Indian used to live only 40 years. So we have increased peoples to live longer. So what we have decided, let us control our children, our fertility. So what happened? Every government wants to reduce fertility. Probably, India was the first country in the world to introduce family planning in the first 5-year plan. First country in the world to introduce 5-year plan, 1950s. Many of us were not born. Some of you listening to the lecture, you were not born in 1950. If you are born in 1950, you would have retired already. Before you were born, there was a control of fertility. Before you were born, we were talking about controlling children. We are not talking about a two-child family. Now China is talking about three-child family. We are not talking about that. But there was a control policy existed in this country in 1950s to control fertility, to control number of birth. People were telling, don't produce more children. It was part of the planning process in this country. And at that time, many people felt, if you want to reduce poverty, you have to reduce the number of people. You want to reduce unemployment, you want to reduce number of people. Of course, some people don't believe that. Some people don't believe, but many governments were started off. India started off with this policy of controlling births, and China thought they are not doing well. Why they felt they are not doing well? Because India was not doing well in fertility. But then we had emergency. During emergency, they have sterilized close to 8 million people in this country. So they control the population during the emergency. So what happened? If you control population, the fertility will take more time to come down. But the political party which played a role will come down soon. And we have seen that. Party lost elections after the emergency. Then of course they came back to power very shortly. But then if you want to control population, sometimes the political party might lose elections. Their people don't like. But now it become normal. And when India had this, in 1979, China introduced one-child family. That means no couples in China can have more than one child. What is the impact? Everybody wants to have a male child. Then they have to abort the girl child. If they want to have a second child, they have to hide. And today, China is talking about three-child family. They had one-child family for quite some time. So many years. They have controlled fertility. They reduced fertility. We know that. We have seen that. One child family. And I went to China in 1990 to look at one child family and its implication for the future of China. And I wrote a paper on that in 1990. And please remember, when the one child family was introduced, wherever I visit among the young couples, all of them had only one child. And it created complete, I will not say complete chaos, but complete family structural change. And these one children, they have no uncle. There is no uncle. Whom you call uncle? No aunties. Everybody has only one child. No periyappa. No chittappa. No relationships. Completely collapsed. You have only one child. Whom you are going to call? When you grow old, your children, there is only one. There is nobody to call you uncle, auntie, periyappa, chittappa. All was gone. Completely gone. So the demography also can change the culture, the family structure of the society. So all countries in the world want to reduce fertility. What happened? Now, one side, mortality has come down, people don't die, people live longer. People live longer. And we control the fertility now. So, and an average Indian today produces just 2 children. And an Indian lives 70 years. So you achieve the maximum, living longer and having less number of children. In fact, Kerala, the state where we live, in 1990, Kerala has achieved 2 child family norm. And I came to 1987 in Kerala to study and work. Only one district in Kerala had high fertility. That was Malappuram. Only one district. Otherwise, Kerala was a clean state with low fertility. Clean state with high fertility. And globally it happened now. Every country has low fertility and low mortality. When you have low fertility, low mortality, the population has to grow. Population is not growing. Because the number of children born has come down. My grandmother had 9 children. I don't think my granddaughter will have 9 children. My grandmother had 9 children. But my granddaughter will not have 9 children. A change in few generations. When you call your mother, my mother is called by my child, a grandparents, then we have one generation is lost. Your mother become grandmother, then there is a new generation is born. New generation is born. And generation takes only 30 years. So within 100 years, the world is completely changed by demography. Now what happened? Because the mortality controlled, fertility controlled, what we are doing from 2000 onwards, we are trying to control migration. Everybody afraid of people. Everybody afraid of people, including America. Not only Kerala people don't like other state people coming in, lot of workers are coming from other states. Even America don't want other people to come in. That's why the last elections, last election, Donald Trump said, America first. Indirectly, what he said was, America is for Americans. And we had the similar voice in 1960, Maharashtra is for Maharashtrians. We have seen the same voice, Malaysia is for Malaysians. So the migration became a hot topic today in the world. Everybody wants to close the border. Everybody want to close the border. Brexit, UK. UK don't want other countries' people. UK want money. But not other countries. You can invest money in UK. There is no barrier to invest in UK. But there is barrier to move people there. There is a barrier. That's called Brexit. They don't want all the Europeans to go in there. They don't mind people invest money. They change capital from Paris to London, they have no problem. But they don't want all the French people moving to UK. That's why they started the Brexit policy. And today every country, Even some states in our own country, in India, they are making a law. The jobs are reserved for locals. Locals. Who is local? Nobody knows. Who is local? Many of us are migrants. We are all migrants. You go back, look at it, many of them are migrants from one city to another city, one state to another state, one country to another country. We are all moving. We are all movers. Everybody is moving. Migrants. Now everybody wants to control. And COVID-19 came as a big opportunity for people to play up migration politics. COVID-19 came as an important tool for many politicians and the government to play politics. On the border. That's why many countries close their border. Forget about countries. Even states close the borders. States close the border. And districts close the border in the name of COVID-19. Triple lock. Even you want to move from district to district, you have to get a pass. You want to move from state to state, you have to get e-pass. Did any one of you heard in your lifetime e-pass? And e-pass was brought by COVID-19. So we are using COVID as an occasion to control or regulate or stop migration or reduce migration. Every week there will be 100 flights will go from Kerala to Gulf. Now the Gulf is, flights are not going. So people are not going. People are losing jobs. So I think this is something very, very important. Before I conclude, I would like to say a few words about COVID-19. Because nothing will move without COVID-19. So COVID-19, I think India has done reasonably well compared to many countries. Though in globally we are number 2 in terms of the absolute number of people affected by COVID, India is number 2 globally. And number of deaths, we are number 3. And the highest number of people died in the world due to COVID-19 is America. So America failed. The big powers in the world surrendered under COVID. Where it came from? It is a psychological war, or a weapon, or a war, we don't know. That's why I always tell people, COVID-19, we are fighting third world war. I have not seen the first world war. I have read it. I have not seen the second world war. I have read it again. You all, maybe some of you might be studying history. You can go back and look at the first world war and second world war. What happened? There will be two group of people fighting against each other. There will be one group in the world, and the world is divided into two groups. They fight with each other. It was the first world war. Second world war, what happened? Same fight. Some people will go and bomb in Japan. Some people will come and bomb. The second world war. There was a group. Why I called COVID-19 as a third world war? COVID-19 made all of us to fight ourselves. There is no group. And also remember, nobody has seen COVID even today. If you know where it is COVID, we would have bombed the COVID. We are very powerful now. If you know there is a terrorist in some one village, we can bomb the whole village. We have powerful bombs. But COVID, none of them have seen. It is moving. It is moving everywhere. 200 countries today COVID is present. 200 countries in the world COVID is present. Indians also present in 200 plus countries. So COVID and Indians are almost like, we are all move. Our mobility is cut down by COVID-19. And Kerala, if you look at it, it did well in the first and reasonably in the second wave. And please remember, Kerala was number 1. Then Prime Minister announced lockdown in last March. Kerala was number one in terms of COVID infection with 100 plus. Maharashtra was number two in last March, but we controlled COVID very well. Of course, I am also I was part of the COVID-19 management committee in May 1. We did very well. Everybody in the world talked about COVID-19 management in Kerala. Everybody flashed. Two things happened during COVID-19. I think Kerala did very well in terms of control, in terms of lockdown, in terms of triple lockdown, in terms of checking back their routes, route maps, all those things. What they did extra is that they also provided livelihood for people. Migrants were protected very well. They were given in the camps. They were given what is called the common kitchen, community kitchen. And then plus, all the people were getting rice, free rice, and some pensions. So they did very well in social security schemes. I don't think anybody starved during COVID-19 wave in Kerala. Added to that, there was a Vande Bharat flight. As per their latest data, Kerala received 15 lakh return migrants. During the elections for the assembly, I was telling many people, the returned migrants who came from the Gulf, normally they never vote because this time they were forced to come to Kerala, and the old people who were given old age pension regularly during the last few years, and especially in the during COVID-19 wave, they are going to rewrite the political history of Kerala. At least 25 to 30 constituencies, they will be deciding factor of which front is going to win. Both returned migrants and the elderly. And I think both of them have gone towards the LDF. After a gap of so many decades, we are giving the government which came back to power second time with the same leader. I think this has to be told, this has to be propagated. COVID played a major role for the government to come back to power. I think we have to talk about that. Thank you very much for listening to me. All the best. God bless you. Take care. Stay safe.